right? You'll walk out to the yellow box in the center of the stage. The head judge will call out your mandatory poses. So it's not a free pose.
Bodybuilding to me is a pure art form of the physique where one is actually sculpting the muscles to have a desired look.
What exactly is a sport? Is it a hobby? We're trying to shape and mold the body to what we think is the ultimate physique.
Whether you're trying to get more muscular, whether you're trying to get leaner.
Go. Okay. Control aggression. Control.
It's basically transforming your physique through the use of diet, cardiovascular exercise, and weight training.
I wish there was something more I could say, you know. I mean, you know, I worked my ass off the entire year, and that's what bothered me. What happened, happened. I got fifth. I'm not fifth, but I was tonight, and that's just the way it is, you know, and I mean, that's bodybuilding. I just gotta bounce back. I mean, you know, measurement of a man is not how you win, it's what happens when you lose and, you know, what you do after that. You know, so we'll see what kind of man I am.
So I currently train at Armbrush Pro Gym. It's located in Wheat Ridge, Colorado. It is definitely not your regular gym. It's I wouldn't say a privately owned gym, but it's not a Gold's or a 24-hour fitness or anything like that. It has every piece of equipment you could ever imagine, and the atmosphere is just unreal. For me, the gym, especially here at Armbrust, is an awesome environment for wellness. It's an awesome environment for me just to get better as a person. I can get better physically, but I can also get better mentally because of the fact of the mental strength that it takes to lift this stuff. And also the emotional release that whatever that's going on past those doors, you bring that in and you can get rid of it. Early on in my career, I mean, it helped prevent me from going out partying every night. It helped me from going out and not being focused on goal setting and stuff. And a lot of people may disagree. And I'm not saying that I don't enjoy a good night out with the guys, but the gym has given my life a lot of purpose because I understand that this is a place of wellness and I want to feel good and look a little bit better.
He went, we've taken him back there when he was, you know.
He didn't, he was, when he was little, yes. I think this was the last time,
that he
with
went there.
Us, yeah, and with then the, he went with Letty
right.
the next time, and mm-hmm. then the following time he went.
With I'm Rosella Braxton Dorsey. Philip is my son.
Why did you stop laughing?
Well, I don't know what else I'm supposed to say.
Yes, well, I'm Philip's stepdad. I met his mother when Philip was almost 4 years old.
So. And what's your name?
Jerry. Oh, I'm Jerry Dawson III.
My sister, whenever she saw Philip, that was one of the main things she always talked about, was how muscular he was, mm. you know, as a kid. You know, and even if you notice in that photograph there, he had big calves. Yeah. He always had big calves.
He did run track, too, for a while, for a couple of years.
That's right.
And his track coach, used to talk about the muscles in his mm-hmm. calves, mm-hmm. when he was running track. Mm-hmm. So yeah, he had to make it right then. And if you notice, I don't know, on some of those basketball games, and you can see it. And then he would stay after school and work out too. He did that because when he was playing basketball, one of the things he would do, he would go to the gym and work out. So he that came natural, I guess. He did it quite regularly.
So a pro bodybuilder can make a living, you know, numerous ways. One will obviously be competition. There is prize money. This can range anywhere from $10,000 prize to $250,000 prize. You can also get endorsement contracts through supplement companies, equipment companies, and then your guest appearance fees. You know, I travel around the world doing seminars and guest appearances.
We're at the 2011 FIBO Power Germany. We got in yesterday from Colorado. It was a long, long trip, but it's well worth it. This right here is the largest international fitness expo in the world. I mean, anybody comes to the FIBO. You know, a lot of people in the States look at bodybuilders, you know, as, you know, not really elite athletes and things of that nature, not household names. But in Germany, at this place, we're like freaking rock stars, so it's awesome. The fans are just incredible.
Thank you, thanks. Thank you. You are the king, my friend.
Oh, thank you.
They don't get to see me very often, and quite frankly, they don't have the mainstream sports that we have here over there.
I like Phil. Last year I've been to the Mr. O contest, and I saw him. I was sitting in the seventh row, and I saw him, and I wish him luck, but This year he will get the Mr. O.
That was the number one day in my life last year. It was my screensaver for 1 year, the picture with him last year. So now I got a new one since I made a photo with him now.
Tell him where you're from.
I'm Michael, I'm from Belgium. And Phil Heath is really my idol.
Oh, thanks, man.
To be
thank
like you.
You,
man, really.
Thank you. I appreciate it, brother. Thanks.
Thanks.
I enjoy getting looked at. There's gonna be a day maybe where I'm not, you know, obviously I'm not gonna be this size forever. And I enjoy it. I'm gonna wish, you know, when I'm 60, 70 years old that something like, hey man, like look at this arm. This arm's gonna be like from 23 inches to like 14 maybe. And I'm gonna wish someone wanted to stare at it, you know? I mean, people are gonna stare. I mean, it's the way it is. If I walk down the street in a string tank top, people are gonna stop and stare. Some people are gonna look at a guy like myself and say, oh, that's gross. But hey, you know, it's not for everybody. I mean, I don't like the way some people look, and it's not a personal thing, it's just preference. A lot of people initially will say, oh, that's disgusting. And then when they see it actually in person and they're actually able to look at it and understand it, that this is an art, they change their mind.
Woo, shit!
You know, different strokes, different folks. I mean, I think it's up to the bodybuilders to realize that it is not normal. It is just not normal. Many people
people that are gonna appreciate you. There are gonna be people that don't like it. And you just have to accept that, you know? And it's just, you have to be more secure within yourself. And ultimately, not, do it for yourself and not worry about what other people think all the time.
The gift, Phil Reese.
Being at the FIBO, you know, you're not just speaking to the German crowd, you're speaking to various audiences that, you know, from all over the world.
Is the guy with the most muscles always the winner, or is it the best poser?
It's usually a little bit of both, but most of the time, I mean, it's a muscle contest, but you have to know how to display it.
Can you show me a bad one and a good one?
I can show you one thing, okay. So like, if a guy was to pose like this, that would only show so much. You see, you're hiding like the tricep area too. Yeah. But all you gotta do is turn it, and then turn, even supinate the wrist. Turn it. You just added another inch and a half on your arm.
Bill compared posing to ballet.
Absolutely, it can be, because in ballet, everything has a purpose. Yeah. Every move has a purpose. Yeah. So with bodybuilding is a purpose-driven lifestyle. You every meal, every rep, every set, everything, every ounce of sleep has a purpose. Everything you do on a daily basis has purpose in bodybuilding. So then you only have a minute to show it.
Yeah.
That's pretty crazy, right? It's almost like being an Olympic athlete. You train 4 years
for
100 meters for 10 seconds. That's crazy.
Honey. You guys must know Honey.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. I love Honey. Mm-hmm. Yes. I love Honey because he puts his heart and soul.
He takes care of them. Sometimes if you see them together, you would think they were married because they'd be arguing back and forth, but he ends up doing what it takes to make a champion, I'd say.
My name is Hani Rambod. I'm a nutritionist, trainer, consultant, contest prep advisor. I deal with everything that has anything to do with contest preparation, both in the off season and pre-contest when it comes to bodybuilding. We're doing shoulders tonight. What we're doing is just trying to get an idea of where his strength is so that we can try to really build on it. Being that we've got only a couple more months left in the off season. Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah. Ooh.
Ooh. Come on, drive.
Feet. Feet. Mm.
Mm. One more. Chuckle.
Yep. Yeah. Oh,
fuck. Feel solid?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Good.
Trying to make sure I get good range. That's what helped last year.
Yep.
But the other thing is also now you're getting stronger as you're starting to mature. So that's making a big difference as well. Phil and I came to work together after he had won the USA Bodybuilding Championships in 2005. And we had met at the show. We ended up hitting it off, talking, and we started to correspond about what things that he was looking to try to improve.
Expect those front delts to be stupid huge. Come Olympia. Come on. Come on. Up slow. Up slow. Up slow.
In Phil's career, my role is training, nutrition, we review supplementation, we review cardiovascular exercise, everything that has anything to do with contest preparation, and then some. I mean, we've become close friends, so sometimes we just talk about cars or any of the other things that go on in our daily lives. But when it comes to the bodybuilding aspect, it's everything that goes into his system and everything that he does when he gets into the gym.
Take the hat off. Same shot. Lean forward. See how thick that is? You just gotta keep, this needs to get a little wider to that right side.
I felt that what was very unique to Phil was that he was coached since he was young. When he was a teenager, he had been coached in basketball. And when we started speaking regarding coaching, I felt that we really could hit it off because he was used to taking constructive criticism and applying that to becoming better. So I felt there was a lot of really good synergy between his work ethic, his coachability, and my coaching ability.
Four, good job. Good job. Whew. Good, way to push through.
You love how I hit my most muscular. I'd be seeing your other clients be trying to do it too.
Yeah.
They'd be like, trying to hit it. I'm like, ah, I'm like, okay. I'm like, yeah, all right. They're like, honey, how does Phil do it? Show me how Phil does it.
He was able to give me a second eye as to what I should be focusing on. We've been working together since my first pro show in 2006 at the Colorado Pro and New York Pro. He's grown from just being, you know, the client and the consultant relationship to more like a friend and almost like family.
Five, come on, five. Four, three, two, one more.
Good job. So we had a really good workout today. Phil just got off the plane late last night from Amsterdam. He was doing appearances all through Western Europe. I was expecting him actually to be a little bit weaker, a little bit more tired. He did pretty good, got a really good pump, was able to go through the workout. We want him to get stronger as the days progress, as we get closer to the show.
One of the craziest parts about being a professional bodybuilder is the travel schedule. I usually travel over 200,000 miles a year, 10 to 15 different countries, doing seminars, meet and greets, guest appearances on stage. And I still have to prepare my own meals. I still have to be organized with where I'm going to train and how I'm going to actually be able to settle down and relax.
Short arms, like T-Rex, and I still beat.
I still have fan mail I have to answer. I still have phone calls I have to take. I still have a family I have to attend to. You have to be a very hard worker. Bodybuilding has taught me a lot of time management, organization.
Where's the black pen? Yeah, it was right up here.
And perseverance.
Thank you, I appreciate it, thank you. Thanks to you.
You need to be probably like 25 to 35 at the most above your competition weight, okay. At the most. Anything more than that is nothing.
I spoke to him about how I'm going to be going into the Army, and the Army has a physical fitness test where it's 2 minutes push-ups, sit-ups, and 2 mile run. And I was like, well, Phil, how would you do on that? And he said, well, I'd probably do really good on the push-ups and sit-ups, but I don't know about the run. And it was kind of funny because I'm a really good runner, and just knowing the fact that he's like, all right, I am human, I can't beat you in the run, but I can do push-ups and sit-ups. That was actually a pretty funny moment. I remember that because I've always wanted to ask him that question.
I gotta tell you once again, those arms are in a league of their own.
Thanks, man.
How long did it take you to get that big? When you were playing college and
10 years. College? Yeah, 10 years, man. Yeah.
It's like people are like, yo, how? And it's time.
Yeah.
Time,
yeah. It just
time.
Takes time, man. Yeah. You just have to be and being consistent.
I went in there to get an autograph and let him know that he's an inspiration for me. Because I used to weigh 358 pounds, now I weigh 170. This is my old picture of me, how big I used to be. My body was overweight. Now I got an 8-pack sitting down and just relaxing. That man is my inspiration.
So this was me before right here. Not whoa! Sure. That was me fat 5 years ago.
What was you eating? Everything.
We're here to meet the champ, Phil Heath.
The gift, baby. Phil Heath's inside.
Came all the way from Philly up here to meet him.
Did you really?
Yes, sir.
We're supposed to go to a birthday party in AC later, but we said the gift, AC. The gift, AC. The gift won. He won.
Nah, he's awesome, man. Keeps the waist small. You know, he looks good. He's not, you know, just looking disgusting awesome. Up there. He looks great.
I have one of those crap days where I'm like, I'm just not feeling. Think of being on that stage, not prepared, and then someone else is looking better than you, and then you're thinking, gosh damn, I should have tried harder that one day. You'll be thinking about it.
What about Jay? You must know Jay by now.
Oh, yeah. I love Jay too.
See, and Philip, I can sit next to me. Jay is the next man that Philip, that my mom loved the best. While I was sitting there, of course.
That's true, he did
say that at the Sunday press conference that time. I remember that. Yeah, we like Jay, because I see you always telling, thanks Jay for taking care of her sons. He said, Jay, thanks for taking care of my boy. Because he is like a son to her, right. Jay is.
Yeah.
As a teenager, I mean, I looked at bodybuilding magazines. My sister's boyfriend had, you know, the first introduced me, I think at 12 years old, and I saw pictures of bodybuilders in the magazine. And, you know, as a kid, you always, like, marvel at, like, superheroes and, you know, like, Spider-Man or, you know, Superman or, you know, Batman, who seemed to have muscles in those suits that they wore. So I think everyone wants to have, as a child, wants to have muscles, and I really believe that's when my passion started.
Another individual that, you know, especially in this industry, means a lot is Jay Cutler. I met Jay April 4th, 2003 at my very first contest here in Boulder, Colorado. And 2 years later, I actually guest posed with him at that same contest.
I saw this kid backstage with, you know, this great physique. He had all the tools to be the best, and I knew it was just a matter of time before he would be up there and eventually battling with me, which of course built the story for the stage the last couple years.
So the 2010 Mr. Olympia, I mean, there's a lot of emotions going through my mind as it was just he and I, the last two guys standing.
Gentlemen, an Olympia tradition, if I may have you in the center line, please.
I wasn't sure, you know, where I was points-wise, but I knew it was fairly close. You know, I trained really hard, and in the previous year, I got a fifth place finish at the 2009 Mr. Olympia. So being top two, I was like, okay, I'm pretty happy about this. And there was a moment where I thought I was going to win.
Please take the title, the check, for $200,000. The Olympia gold medal. And the Sandow statue and the title of Mr. Olympia. And take it to Jay Cutler!
And then they announced Jay as the winner. And even on the video, I was actually more relaxed afterwards because it was more like a sigh of relief. Like, wow, like the pressure is off of me. Like, okay, I didn't win, but I wasn't disappointed. I was actually pretty happy, probably because it was like my best friend winning. You know, I was more happy that he won. And we both got to share that experience together. No one else was there. We weren't divided. We were just together on the stage. And, you know, I was happy for him. I don't even, you know, remember being upset.
Running up this evening, the gift.
I was able to battle it out with, you know, not only a fantastic bodybuilder, but, you know, it turned into be a great friendship. That continues to grow. And I think a lot of these days, because of the strain of the finances and what's on table for the Mr. Olympia competitions and, you know, the contracts and endorsements, there's a lot of tension between a lot of athletes. But I was able to share a lot with Phil and introduce him to a lot of opportunity. And he's taken great advantage of it. He's really stepped up.
And it's pretty awesome to look at someone initially and be in awe as a fan. It's another thing to actually call that fan and that person that you look up to as a brother. And that's where we're at right now.
I'm going to put him on the website, though, because most guys don't wear triples. So, I mean, obviously you do, but see, best of luck, man. Get off your feet, man. Get off your feet, bro. How you been, man? Since last time? Yeah?
Yeah, holding it down, man. Working my ass off.
Yeah, that's cool.
Want to turn to the right?
Steve Weinberger. There's a few head judges. I'm one of them. What a judge does is the lineup comes out of the guys and we look for size, shape, symmetry, and condition.
Which basically means how big the muscle bellies are, how much that they balance one another from your upper body to the lower body, your left side to your right side, and then the overall leanness of the physique.
Most people think, you know, how do you do that? You know, is it hard? How could you figure it out? Honestly, when the guys get on stage, usually it all, once they start posing, it all unfolds right in front of you, and it's pretty easy to pick out. Some things, I mean, you could change on your shape, but you're born with what you're born with. If you have a wide waist, you have a wide waist. You need to try to make your shoulders wider and you sweep your thighs wider to make your waist appear smaller. But some guys are just gifted and have like tiny waists and big muscle bellies, and those guys, you know, if they train real hard, they usually are the guys that go to the top. Phil's one of those guys, like I said earlier, has all the right tools. And with the right heart, he's a very dangerous bodybuilder. What he needed to improve, and he did, was he needed to improve his back. His shoulders and arms are always overpowering. He brought up his back, he brought up his chest, he brought up his legs, and I'm sure he's gonna keep improving and keep getting better and better. We usually call him out in either groups of three or groups of five. And those groups are usually what we think would be that top three or that top five, the next five or the next three, and sometimes we'll call them back out, maybe with one person missing, because when we call the other group, we'll think, this guy in the second group actually is good enough to belong in the first group, and that first guy in the first group, we gave him a shot, but he doesn't belong. So we keep calling until we get the right combination of your top five, your next five, your next five, and so on and so forth, right down the line.
And then, you know, going into posing to your own music that you've worked on, that you've choreographed your routine to, now you can hit all the signature poses that you always wanted to hit, whereas the mandatories are mandatories. They may not be as fun for that person, so. And then they do a final posing round, a pose down. You're bringing the fire. You're going after one another.
When a particular bodybuilder is doing a posing routine or when they're doing a pose down, they're gonna stick to the strengths. If somebody turns around and does a particular shot and then the other person does the same thing, they're basically trying to say that mine is just as good as yours, if not better. So what they're trying to do is show the other person up.
When you're trying to be the best in the world at something, you want to claw and scratch and fight for that. So when you see us moving each other around, yeah, we're trying to solidify our position as the best bodybuilder in the world.
The Mr. Olympia competition is definitely its own level, because that is the contest that everyone has to qualify for. You have to have the prestige of being one of the top bodybuilders in the world to get into that competition.
Yeah, out of the 47 years that the Mr. Olympia contest has been held, only 12 people have earned that title. Call themselves Mr. Olympia, winning the Eugene Sandow Trophy. It is the Super Bowl of bodybuilding. It is the best of the best of the best of the best. You will be enshrined in history. You will be an automatic Hall of Famer. So getting ready for that show, everything was, you know, put on hold just so that I could focus 100% to be, you know, number 13, Mr. Olympia.
Let's go.
Something told me to invite my trainer, Honey Rambod, to do legs with me, or to help spot me. At first it was just, oh, he'll just come hang out. Then it started from that to, oh, he'll just spot me on a couple sets, to putting me through a full workout. There's a huge difference, I feel like, when you're training for the Mr. Olympia as opposed to other contests.
I go one, two, three, four, and then hold it down there, and then one, two, three, four, hold it, and while you're like 12. Yeah. Come on, no problem, man, dude. You got this shit.
You know, when you're training for the Mr. Olympia, you're training to be the face of bodybuilding. You're training to be one of a very elite group of individuals that have achieved, you know, that title. And, you know, I would say that the sense of urgency is like no other.
Good job, good job, good job.
There's nothing else like it. I mean, you have to dedicate your life to this. I mean, you have to eat, sleep, train consistently for years.
every rep counts. Every set counts. Everything counts. And it did even prior to that, but it even more so does now.
There you go. Good. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. So get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up.
So what he's going through right now is the burn, the afterburn. And that afterburn is because he's kept his legs upside down for, I don't know, six, seven sets.
Normally you do seven sets with like 40 seconds rest. He was looking at his watch, but I swear to God, he was only doing like 20 seconds. He was trying to kill me.
You know pretty much what those, what your competition is doing to get there. See, even if they achieve greatness, I've got to be just amazing. I'm working extremely hard, respecting everybody else, but I should want better for myself. I should want to push through the limits and see how far I can take this. I have to reach high. And I realize that it's one day at a time, one step at a time.
On stage, baby. Stage. Good quads on stage. Come on, two more steps. One, two.
One more, motherfucker! Yeah!
When I say MF, I'm talking about myself. I'm like, sorry, Mom. That stuff's heavy, though. Whew.
I expect nothing but greatness out of myself. It could be me playing Nintendo, you know, on the old school power pad. I'd be in there running my ass off, trying to beat you. Like, I would play freaking tic-tac-toe with your ass and still try to, you know, checkers. I don't care what it is. I mean, I'm just a competitive person.
The Mr. Olympia contest is usually held on a Friday and Saturday night. So on Wednesday, we usually have the athletes check in, and that's, I mean, it's nothing special. You know, we just go over instruction, and then we may visit with each other, do a couple mild interviews for online and for our sponsors. But then Thursday, that evening, we have the Meet the Olympians, and that's freaking awesome. That's, you know, something that I actually enjoy doing. We set up my booth, and every fan gets to come up, you know, treat it like an expo. It's the expo before the expo, basically. And it's their first and pretty much only time they're really gonna get all their questions really answered before I step on stage.
Oh, yeah. How you doing?
I couldn't believe you didn't class.
Oh, well, that's why we're here this year, so we can make it happen. Right? Looks like I got a mustache right there.
Just show them all this weekend, okay?
Some of us are really tense, but I know for me, you know, I've got like a silent aggression going on, and I'm just like, you know, doing my thing. I'm in my zone.
All right, you guys, we're in the second leg of two legs, I guess, at the Meet the Olympians. We just had the VIPs come in, and man, there's a lot of people that came in to wish me good luck, to ask me a few questions. I did a few interviews, and now, The second leg is here, which is the general public. And because of that, I'm trying to sit down, actually get into this meal real quick.
Oh, this year is the year. I said that last year, but this year for sure, he's gonna be number one. He was so close last year. He's very talkative and he just seems more relaxed this time. I mean, we came into town yesterday and when we saw him, and he just looked fantastic, so.
Does it get any easier?
No, it doesn't. I was even nervous for him this morning, even though it was just a meet and greet, you know? So no, it doesn't get any easier.
I would have stayed there all night, but being the fact that I had to get more meals in and get rest, I had to get out of there. So I was there for probably a couple hours, easy.
So now I gotta go tan.
Tired?
Hell yeah, I'm tired. I'm very tired. But
all part of the job.
This is all part of the gig right now, you know? I mean, I'm trying to be the 13th Mr. Olympia, trying to be the best ambassador of the sport of bodybuilding. So doing events like this is extra pleasure. Hey, thank you guys. Appreciate it. You know, that's what you gotta do. You know, even if you're dead ass tired, I mean, you gotta shake those hands. You gotta take pictures with people. These people paid a lot of money to fly out, especially in a recession. Come on, man. They spent money in a recession in a cult sport to come out, to come meet guys like me. That's love, man.
Smooth strides in between here.
So one of the funniest aspects of being a pro or just a bodybuilder in general is the tanning.
You're sitting there in a tent and they're spraying your battle armor.
Coming straight down the middle and then maybe adding a little bit here, shading the top of the abs and the pectoral muscles, nice and smooth strides.
I'm a very light-skinned black guy, and if I were to go up on stage just like this, as you see me in this video, I would be the whitest guy on stage because of the stage lighting, and it wouldn't show the detail that I worked so hard for. Putting on that tan with the lighting involved, it just makes you look like a totally different person.
While we're here, just go ahead and catch the side of the head. Want everything to be uniform in terms of the color.
Obviously, when you see us off stage, we look super, super dark and sometimes kind of ugly because it's just really weird. But it's super necessary because when you see us under those hot lights and you see people take photos, you can tell that, wow, like, his tan's really good.
Going over the fingers.
And the last thing you want to do is cost yourself a placing due to something so simple into making sure that your tan is good.
And ladies and gentlemen, that's how it's done.
I'm black.
So Friday, leading up to the prejudging, it's showtime, man.
You ready?
This is it. All the blood, sweat, and tears, man. Little nervous because I know what's at stake. I know that right now I'm only minutes away from stepping on stage and showing these guys what I've worked on for the last year. But definitely feel confident about it. And just ready to go get it on. So let's go do it.
Leaving the hotel, all I have is just, you know, my little carry-on lunchbox, like my clothes, and
I've got to know that, you know, I am Mr. Olympia. I have to feel that. You know, I have to know that. I've had to know that since last year that I put the work in, you know, the blood, sweat, and tears into this. I'm going to win. I just want to be able to say after tonight and tomorrow night, someone say, "Did you leave any left for us?" Like Arnold said, just bodies.
So I walk in there, and there's this long hallway that leads backstage to the pump up room, and it's usually, you know, real cold. I don't know why it's cold in there, but it just feels cold. And during that time, I get a chance to, I guess, get in my zone, and. You know, a lot of people say, get your head in the game and this and that. Usually my head was in the game a year ago. Now it's just a little bit more serious because I realize that there ain't no turning back now, dude. There's nothing else I could have done from here on out to make myself look any better.
Backstage, the guys, you know, there's a lot of tension, but we're all looking at each other and we're vying for the most valuable crown in bodybuilding, the biggest purse. And it's the end of the year show where it's kind of like all your eggs fall into the Mr. Olympia.
You just almost see like almost a bunch of dead bodies. Guys just laying down, resting, trying to get their feet up, just trying to stay cool and calm. Everybody's trying to, you know, at the corner of their eye, checking out each other, looking through the mirror. OK,
okay, he's on, okay, he's missing this and this and this. I wonder what I look like. But let, you know, like we're all trying to size each other up. You can feel the tension. You can definitely feel the tension, especially on Friday night.
Gentlemen, we'll be starting in approximately 15 minutes.
So there's a moment in time, you know, as you're going from backstage and your number's being called to go up for your individual compulsory poses, that is very, very, very stressful. All your hard work and dedication is now going to be showcased on stage, and you're just hoping that everything, all your posing practice, all your meals, I mean, your mind's going 100 different directions, but what I try to do is, as my name's getting called, I try to take as many deep breaths as I can, because I want to get oxygen in the brain so I don't freaking faint, pass out. But more importantly, I just want to feel calm. There's no reason to be nervous. There's no reason to be scared. There's no reason to fear anything.
Competitor 22 from the USA, The Gift, Phil Heath.
I ain't playing around. I ain't come here for no game. You know, I came here to battle. You know, front double bicep is always my favorite, you know, because it gets the crowd going. It sets the tone. You know, it's a gun show, man. And then I, you know, hit the side shots, you know, people go nuts, and then I turned around. And I remember hitting a back double bicep. And that's when the whole crowd, I felt it. It was like, I wanted to hold that pose forever. Kind of like how Arnold would say back in the day, he would say, you know, some poses, you know, when the crowd cheers, you want to hold them longer. And when they don't cheer, you want to get the hell out of there. But this one, I wanted to hold for an eternity.
They call him The Gifts, Phil Heath.
Getting ready to do the round of six guys. They bring six guys out at a time.
Side chest.
The difference between last year's Olympia and this year's was the fact that they brought just Jay and I into that last comparison. And I still remember, even in 09, how I felt when I wasn't gonna be in that last call out. And then in 2010, how I was in that last call out, but it was in a group, it was in a larger group. But this time I got exactly what I wanted, which was to have my moment, just one and two, mano a mano, getting after it on that stage where everyone gets to see who's the best on Friday night. So after Friday night, you know, I walk out, I get my things together and walk out of the Orleans Arena. There, you know, they have a lot of fans waiting for each athlete, take pictures with and stuff like that, ask questions. Well, I kind of, instead of going out one door, I went out the other side door. I kind of beelined it to my crew. Because I had like 50 people from Colorado that went. So everybody was just like, you did it, like you won. I mean, there's still Saturday. It ain't over yet. Like that last year, you know, so.
We'll be there tonight to watch the
Yeah, I hope so, man. Hope so, dude. Yeah.
Leading until Saturday afternoon when I went into the expo, it was definitely a positive, you know, when I was at the T-Muscle Tech booth.
Looks like you're going to take it down tonight, man. That's what everyone's saying. That's the word.
What's up, boss?
Hey, bro, can I get one made out of DP?
DP?
Yeah.
You got it.
Mirror bikes.
Right on, man.
I wish you the best of luck, man.
Hey, thanks, bro.
Night.
It went, it's,
well?
Yeah, let's keep our fingers crossed, huh?
Good deal.
Weirdest feeling in the world right now.
Really? How so?
Because I feel like it's the changing of the guard as we speak. You know what I mean? But I still have to make it happen, you know, that's the problem.
I'm just trying to conserve as whatever energy I got for the stage, you know? You guys going to a nice show?
Yeah.
You got to show me some love, man.
There's a little bit of pressure, you know, like just to make sure that I don't do anything bad, because I've never been in this situation before where a lot of people feel like I'm going to win. So I'm just crossing my fingers, you know, saying a few prayers, just trying to stay focused, that's all. And feel confident. Once I get up on that stage, you know, tonight, hopefully, you know, after I eat up and I've rested, that I can show the world, you know, who I really am, and hopefully shock the world and become the 13th Mr. Olympia. That's the goal. Saturday night's a little bit more relaxed. People have had a little bit of extra food in them. They may have some fluids, and they kind of know where they're going to place. So they're just kind of waiting for their judgment to be made. But for those top six, if not top three, top two guys, it's still a war. It's still nerve-wracking as hell until, you know, it's all over.
Gentlemen, your top 15, 21, Johnny Jackson, 22, Phil Heath, 24, Jay Cutler.
Now, I think it was definitely in the room that I was gonna win. I mean, I had a few competitors, you know, shake my hand, and I'm thinking, man, y'all did this last year. But, you know, then the writers, you know, all said the same thing, which was, you were right. You said that you shocked the world, and my God, you shocked the world.
Winners. Everybody wants to be a winner. Winning is everything, huh? Nah, winning is the only thing.
There was a moment inside that routine that I was able to finally take it all in, and I was just like, you did it. You nailed it. The crowd's going crazy. You feel like Mr. Olympia. Now let it out. Let everybody see it. Just like, hell yeah, man. I'm just like, yeah, you know, just going crazy.
It's the gift for me.
And we're getting back in the pump-up room, and people were just like, it was pretty quiet back there. People were just like, man. So then after that, you know, we have a confirmation round. Instead of having me be compared with the top six, they just had Jay and I come out together. And that was our last shot leading into the pose down to let the fans see who is better compared, you know, who's the number one out of all these different mandatory poses. And I just felt that I kept getting better and better and better with each pose, and my confidence grew more and more and more. And like I said, it didn't really have to do with anybody else on that stage at that moment. It wasn't about anybody else, it was just about me. And I was just having a blast.
All right, guys, finish it off. Most muscular.
Is this the pose that decides the winner?
Yeah.
The most nerve-wracking experience is judgment time, which is the awards. So lead into that, you know, you got your top six and then top three.
You may take that to our third place finisher, the Predator, Kai Green.
And then once they called Kai third, I was like, oh man, here we go again. Me and Jay, round two. And then we both walk out.
If I could have Phil Heath and Jay Cutler in the center stage, please.
And we both knew, you know, he was gonna win.
He was more mentoring me during that process, saying, you know, take a deep breath, it's gonna be okay, like, you look really good.
All of our presenters are on stage, along with our IFBB Pro President, Mr. Jim Mannion. Will Jay score five, or will the torch be passed?
And I think he was kind of like, wow, you know, this is really gonna happen. His face got really serious when I told him that for a minute. He's like, he was trying to hold back, you know, I think the emotions.
Gentlemen, in Olympia tradition, the next name you hear will be the 2011 Mr. Olympia.
And I just told him, I said, you know what, you know, this is your time. This is what you always wanted. And, you know, really, really enjoy this, Phil, because, you know, this is a once-in-a-lifetime deal.
I could just remember him saying, wait for it, wait for it. You know, enjoy this moment.
We take the first place award, the Olympia gold medal, the check for $200,000, the Sandow bronze award, and the title of 2011 Mr. Olympia to our winner tonight.
Every time you win in this sport, especially being Miss Olympia, it's like your whole career flashes before. It goes from current all the way to rewind from the very beginning, all the way back to the present within like milliseconds. It's like your life flashes before your eyes. It wasn't even about beating Jay Cutler, it was about winning the Olympia. It was about being the best. So I never was like, yeah, I beat Jay. No, I beat everyone. I was the best.
Now stand there with the gold medal around your neck, the Sandow, and the big check, and most importantly, the title of 2011 Mr. Olympia.
Wow. I really, oh my goodness. Heck yeah, I did it.
I am one of his greatest fans. I'm his mom, and I can't believe it.
He has been one of the most wonderful sons that you could have.
Obviously, I have to thank, Jay.
He's really stepped up and became not just the fan that he was. He's now living, I believe, what is his dream, and now he sees as his future.
He told me, you know, that I had great potential, and I thought he was full of it, you know, but he believed, and, you know, I'm just very happy that I had, and I still have, you know, a best friend in Jay, so I have to say thank you.
And of course, I see great, great things in the future for Phil Heath, and I really look forward to being, continuing to be a part of what he achieves.
But I definitely gotta thank Hani Rambod. I just have to say, Hani, you're one of my best friends in the whole world. You're my brother from another mother, and I love you to death, man.
Did I always want him to win the Olympia? Yes, but it was something that I turned around and I expected. I expected if we did really hard work, that we would get a very good result.
Tears of joy.
This is definitely the best and the hardest sport I've ever tried in my entire life, and I'm enjoying every minute of it, and I hope that each and every one of you can grasp something from each of these men and women that you've seen here tonight and take it with you and apply it to your lives, you know, to be better people, you know, whether it be in bodybuilding or whatever your endeavors are. Man, I don't really have anything else to say other than the fact that I just love all you guys for coming out and staying here and just really repping the sport of bodybuilding. And I just want to say thank you. And hopefully this is one of many. I really hope so. Thank you.
The Phil Heath era has begun, ladies and gentlemen. I introduce the 2011 Mr. Olympia, Phil Heath.
Knowing that I'm the 13th Mr. Olympia means everything to me right now, because I'm actually fulfilling my destiny as being an Olympia champion. I am the reigning and new Mr. Olympia champion. No one is better than me. Now there's a question of how many can he win and how far he's going to be able to take the sport with him while he's winning. You know, for me, I think that I'm at a perfect age and in great health that I'm in a really good spot. I can't help but to think that I can win multiple titles. I have to think like this. I know a lot of people will say, well, that's being arrogant, that's being cocky. I have to reach high. Man, I used to rap my music from my tiny bedroom, and though I dreamt of being free, I felt trapped like in a tomb. And even though the times are dark and I can barely even see through all the tears, I sit and pen, weave out my destiny. But now the days are gone where I would listen to the critics who counted me out before they ran the proper analytics. I'm here to stay just like a necklace waiting to be pearled, and I'm throwing up the chorus as I'm singing with the world.
To who watch all of the things you do. I hate to break it to you, not everyone wants the best for you. Who try to take the dream inside you, they see they're flat out jealous and envy all the things you will be. Yeah, just hold your head up, man, and keep on moving on. If I would have never struggled, then I wouldn't have this song. But don't get me wrong, no need to stack up your strife. You gotta watch the ones who you let speak straight into your life. Cause the artists, they will sing you all their fancy little songs with the funny little beats and all the catchy sing-alongs. But the messages they give are not the kind you should be fed. It's a recipe of lies they try to get stuck in your head. Man, I see some rappers sold their souls, I won't be selling mine. No need to find a source when you're eating from the vine. You thought that I was done, but now I'm leaving you behind. Wouldn't say I deserve it, but I'm here to get what's mine.